In a 1999 interview with Art New England, Gregory Gillespie channeled a priest. Adopting the bullying, self-righteous tone he recalled so vividly from his youth, Gregory spat out these words. "Take a match and put it under your finger. Imagine how hot that is, how much it hurts. Well, your whole body is going to be burning like that, and there's going to be no relief if you don't do what we say."
Maybe you got a kid. Maybe you got a pretty wife. The only thing that I got been bothering me my whole life.
A character in a Bruce Springsteen song sings, "Maybe you got a kid, maybe you got a pretty wife. The only thing that I got been bothering me my whole life." Gregory Gillespie was not that guy. He had a lot in his life, including worldly success, loyal friends, and an absolute genius for art. But I do think he also had something that bothered him his whole life. I met him only once when I was a drunken art student and he came to the opening of an important group show of realists that he was in at the Pennsylvania Academy of the Fine Arts in Philadelphia. I was in the men's room and looked over as I was urinating. There he was, standing right next to me. I yelled out his name, stuck out my hand, and he shook it. He was the nicest famous artist I have ever met. In 1977, when Gregory was only 40 years old, he had a major retrospective at the Hirshhorn Museum in Washington, D.C. In the year 2000, at the age of 63, he hung himself. Gregory studied art at Cooper Union and then got a master's degree from the San Francisco Institute of Art. I heard that he had the great Richard Diebenkorn as a teacher there and that Diebenkorn urged him to use bigger brushes and paint looser. Sometimes one great artist is wise to ignore the advice of another, which is what Gregory did. He got a Fulbright to study the Renaissance painter Masaccio and spent the 1960s living and painting in Italy. He and his wife Frances lived first in the countryside outside of Florence, where Gregory concentrated on landscapes. They later moved to Rome, where he painted interiors, trattorias, and street scenes. Through Bella Fischko, he connected to the Forum Gallery in New York and also got into several Whitney biennials. His work eventually was collected by many museums. After Italy, Greg and Fran moved to Western Massachusetts, where they lived for the remaining years of their lives. I met a couple who owned several works by Gregory Gillespie. They wanted to remain anonymous, but the husband allowed me to record him speaking. He told me why they believe Gregory is in a class of his own.
I would go back to something that his gallery dealer, Bella Fischko, used to say to us. And every time we went into the gallery and we're talking about Gregory, she would say in this impassioned tone of voice, "He's a genius. He's a genius," repeatedly. And our feeling was, he is. So the experience of collecting this man was very special. We have collected a lot of really wonderful artists. But Gregory, I think, is almost unique in terms of his vision and the way he expresses his vision and his craft. No one else does anything like this, and no one else has that depth of creativity.
I talked by phone with two of Gregory's closest friends, painters Scott Pryor and Robin Friedenfeld.
Scott, thanks so much
for talking to me about your friend Gregory Gillespie. How did you guys meet?
Sure. I'd seen his work at a show at the Whitney Museum when I was in college at UMass, 69 and 70, and it was an incredible show. It was called Human Concern, Personal Torment. And he had one of his Italy shrine paintings in the show, and it just blew me away. And I always remembered that painting. When I graduated from UMass with a degree in printmaking, I started to paint on my own. And I thought of him a lot, and I went down to see his work at the Forum Gallery. Shortly after, somebody came over to my apartment in Northampton and said, there's a show of Greg Gillespie's over at Smith College. I went over, and I asked the person, why is he showing here? And they said, he lives here. He just moved here. He and his wife, Fran, and their two little kids, they bought a farmhouse out in Williamsburg, one town away from Northampton, to the country, a beautiful ramshackle old house. And I got to meet him at the show. I'm a very shy guy, and I had a nice talk with him, and he said, give me a call. I probably wouldn't have, except that I bumped into him again at the library just a week later. And so we talked some more. He was very inviting, so I went out and showed him some of my paintings. And he had, henceforth, a major impact on my learning how to paint.
Other painters in the area were also attracted to Gregory.
We're all still friends, and we all have the common experience of being very much affected by Greg when he moved to town, when we were all younger. Jane Lund, Randy Deal, Robin Friedenfels, all good friends of Greg's, a few others, too. And they even invented a name for us, Valley Realist School. We never called ourselves that. It just wasn't a school or nothing was founded. It was just we were friends. We got known. All of us had varying degrees of success.
I asked Scott if Gregory was the head of this group.
Yeah, head is another term that might have been used and we wouldn't have liked it, but he was the elder statesman, the oldest, and he had the most success.
Around 1978, Robin Friedenfeld was visiting from Chicago, thinking about moving to Western Massachusetts. She told me how she met Gregory Gillespie at an art opening of Scott Pryor's.
He appeared to me at the time to look like a homeless person. He just had that affect. We hit it off really well. We found out we both liked to play tennis, and we started playing tennis, and we became very good friends, and he had told me he was an artist, but I didn't know of him. I was coming from the world of printmaking.
Gregory had invited her to his studio, but she put him off.
A year later, I was at the Whitney, and I saw that painting of Greg on the mattress. I looked at it, and I thought, oh my God, that's Greg.
After that, she began to visit his studio.
I spent many, many years with him in his studio, and he would be working, and I'd be watching. And I learned a lot watching him. When I did the portrait of him after he died, I also used a lot of the things that he taught me, glazing and sanding, a lot of that skin.
The teaching was not a one-way street. Here is Gregory Gillespie's first etching after printmaker Robin taught him how to do it.
Greg was a very tough critic. I know when he came to look at my paintings, he had no qualms to pick up a brush and just start working on it. He'd be right, though. A lot of what he said was right on.
Scott detailed the technical aspects of how Gregory constructed his artworks.
Organic, the way he approached a painting. He would cut paintings in half. He would glue things to paintings. He would cover them with gel and paint over, build up these layers of paint. Sometimes he'd add panels and extend the painting. He would nail stuff to the board. When he had a still life, he had the objects there. He would paint from life. He'd paste down photographs, not really trying to hide them, but most of the time he'd paste down something and then paint over it, integrating it into the larger painting. Not that often would he talk about what they meant, what this object was symbolic of, or anything. They didn't do that, and I didn't ask, because what I took away from his paintings was much more visceral. I love that combination of obsessiveness, of a detail, reference to Renaissance painters, and his combining that with iconography from the present, objects that were clearly of the here and now, and his mixing up the tight realism with a lot of experimental stuff, a lot of layering. I often thought that his paintings reflect the passage of time as much as anything, because you could sort of feel the way a wall in a city shows all the remnants of decades and 100 years, and there it all lives. It's like his paintings felt that way to me.
In the catalog for his 1970 Forum Gallery show, Gregory stated,
"Too many words have been written about art and artists. I have decided that this book should consist of the reproductions alone."
But in the catalog for his 1977 Hirshhorn retrospective, Gregory had a lot more to say.
"The technique is photo collage. You can see the outlines in some of the figures. You know the Balthus street scenes? It came out of those." "If the paint on the palette gets interesting, I'll pick it up and paste it down on a panel and start painting into the shapes, Rorschaching into it." The walls were alive to me. I remember thinking that the real theme of the people in the landscapes was alienation. They're not integrated into a landscape the way a Renaissance mind would do it. It was playing with that theme. I don't fit here.
After Gregory's death, Robin Friedenfeld became a trustee for his artwork. She found numerous journals that he kept during the years of his art career.
"These are conversations, I guess, he's having with himself. I think he wrote every day. I don't know if he ever thought that these would be available to the public, but he definitely wanted them to be part of his estate and his art."
Tuesday, August 15th, 1995, Provincetown. "Trying to narrow the gap between painting and writing by keeping this paper right next to my painting to see what will happen. Sanding the sky in a red landscape is like fishing for images. Patience, the right tools, 600 grade sandpaper. The right technique, not too light, not too heavy, the right preparation. Many skies overlaid on top of each other. With sanding, if I'm lucky, it will reveal images and combinations that I could not have pre-imagined. After the sandpaper comes the single-edged razor blade. This is when the paint starts flying and getting a certain patina. Yesterday, in certain places, I went too far. That's okay. Now it becomes an underpainting for today's passion."
Cool, huh?
Yeah. "Those outlines inscribed right into the paint describe things that might be there, like a table leg, but it didn't have to be represented. I did stuff like that in other works, too. Maybe it stayed in the painting for a long time. Then I'd take it out with a razor blade. But there would still be traces, which I'd leave in. So it's as if it were there, or is there in another dimension. I like that because it gives a suggestion of time."
He seemed wide open to any inspiration that would further his visionary aims.
"In Italy, everything was strange. Not everything made sense. In Rome, I love the trattorias. I used to hang out in these places. I drink, usually by myself. And after the right amount of alcohol, it would start to look very powerful, and it did have this melancholy quality. It wasn't a cheerful thing. On the street, I once found the paper backing you throw away from Polaroid film, and it had this brownish kind of stuff in the lines. There was a pattern in it. It was a very beautiful pattern and suggested these shapes and creatures. So I took it home and glued it down, and I painted on it. Lots of people say Bosch or Bruegel when they speak of my work. I've liked them from time to time. I don't know who these kinds of paintings really relate to. Maybe that Victorian Irish painter, Richard Dadd. He was actually insane, and he painted little creatures.
In her New York Times obituary for Gregory Gillespie, Roberta Smith wrote,
"He found inspiration in several centuries of European painters, including Balthus, Bacon, Beckmann, Bosch, Bruegel, Van Eyck, Masaccio, and Crivelli. He also drew from Indian sculpture, Tibetan mandalas, and Chinese and Mayan art."
Scott pointed out what he believes to be another very important influence.
It was very clear that he was very affected by the Spanish painter Antonio Lopez Garcia. He had lived over in Italy, and I remember Fran once saying that he drove from Italy to Spain to see his paintings and maybe meet him. So he was a very, very big influence.
In a journal entry read by Robin, Gregory reveals his alienation from the contemporary art world.
November 1st, 1994. For 30 years, I've been out of the loop, out of fashion. I've lived out in the country in Belchertown, Massachusetts. I hardly know anyone in New York City. And so far, I've survived, made a living with my art. I'm not a thinker about art. I hardly ever talk about it. I only talk about my own art. I'm happy to talk about my art to whomever wants to talk with me about it, but I just don't think about other people's art. The movements have come and gone. I read about them sporadically in the art journals. I keep track once in a while of the Red Sox in the Boston Globe. I haven't liked much art since the pop artists. I didn't like them much, still don't. Never liked Warhol, minimalist, conceptualist, op artists, installation art, postmodern. I've tried to like all of it, but I just want to look at paintings that are delicious to look at, like the great art of the past. It doesn't matter to me that I'm old-fashioned. I love paintings that are sensual and eccentric and dare to challenge the current art dogmas. How come all the museum shows look the same these days? On the other hand, I will admit that I want more recognition. I want a major museum show of my work. I suppose I want more money. There is a part of me that is ambitious and completely vain, which thinks I'm making great art. And at the same time, I thrive very well without all that. I've got enough. Why want more? Maybe this is perfect.
The naturalistic impulse, going back to observing carefully, it always revitalizes art. There's always conflict in the painting. There's a wanting to make it as real as possible, but not believing in it at the same time. I know that my flesh is made of chemicals and molecules. I know that what I'm seeing is like a dream. I know that consciousness is something else, but somehow connected to this physical chemical plane. There's a crazy bewilderment that we all seem to live in, not knowing really what is happening or how it could possibly be happening.
I asked Scott Pryor some questions about Gregory's family life.
Gregory had a somewhat traumatic childhood. Did he ever talk about his parents?
Not really. I don't have a lot of specific recollections of actual conversations. It's more like kind of a feeling of things. And I don't remember him dwelling on his parents and his difficult childhood. Someone asked him, he'd spill his guts. He didn't hold back about anything. No shame. His immediacy and his honesty and directness were one of the very appealing aspects of his character. No, he didn't talk about that. You find it in interviews and catalogs, and it's there.
I did find some things online that he said about this.
My childhood was quite unusual, having a crazy mother who was institutionalized for the rest of her life when I was 5 years old, and a severely alcoholic father. I look around at the images I paint now and I see Catholicism, insanity, chaos, weirdness. It's natural for me to create these images. It's almost as if, since there was so much chaos in my childhood, my job as an artist is to make it beautiful, to give it back some order and stability, and to make a living from it. All my paintings, no matter how free the brush marks, are figurative. They tell stories. It's an attempt at self-healing. I always use the content of my life in my paintings. It's how I work on what's going on. This painting has one of those figures that recurs all the time in my work, a woman walking away. She's even in the paintings I was working on just recently. For whatever it's worth, I always assumed it was an image of my mother.
He talks about his aunt in his childhood a little bit.
Oh, could you read that?
Okay. Friday, August 11th, 1995, 6:10 a.m. Last day of teaching my workshop, setting out the paints on my palette. I think of a poem I could write about paint and the names of paint. Exotic names: ivory black, burnt sienna, raw umber, cadmium yellow, Venetian red, and how over the years a painter comes to love each color for what it can do and what it can't do. Today I've laid out a lot of fresh colors. I have so many tubes of paint in a cardboard box that I have to rummage through with both hands to find the color I need, burnt sienna. In looking for it, I found other colors that I was happy to find again: cobalt blue, alizarin crimson. A while ago, I found a tube of paint for sale called permanent alizarin crimson, and I bought it. Now I use either of them, but I feel more virtuous when I use the one labeled permanent. When I was putting the paints out, I heard a voice in my head calling me, saying, "Dear, are you okay with the cadmium orange, dear?" The voice is a blend between my student Barbara and my Aunt May, the only nurturing female in my childhood. I've never felt any gratitude towards her. In my mind, I always think about how inadequate she was, how she abandoned me when I was 12. I could find that burnt sienna. I kept looking and finally found not one tube, two together. It sets me thinking about how they came to be together in that instant, which reminds me of the odds that my father's specific sperm, which reached my mother's specific egg, would have the genetic code that resulted in me coming into being. How many zillions to one? So the poem would start with the basic chore of finding and then setting out fresh paints, and then move into the limitless and the imponderable. Valley green, red ochre, Naples yellow, Prussian blue, and the missing blue Hogar, my favorite blue.
Wow.
I think when you're listening to his thought process, you can see how he's putting everything together all the time.
Oh, man.
I wondered how his childhood might affect his relationships as an adult. Scott shared his impressions of the Gillespie family.
I was very good friends with his wife, Fran, who passed away of cancer 20 years ago. She was too young. And I knew the kids very close to the family as a unit. I still have this memory of meeting them all in the house, in the kitchen. They didn't care much about material stuff. So the house was sort of in ill repair, and I think they tried to fix it up a little bit, but it was all incomplete. It was just a mess. They didn't really care about that kind of thing. They just wanted a place to cook, a place to sleep, a place to paint. And I remember my impression of the two, Greg and Fran, was that they were just not your typical grown-ups. He was at least 10 years older than me. They felt like a different generation. They were married. They had kids and so forth. And I remember Fran was a bundle of energy. She hardly ever finished a sentence. They were very aesthetic. They had these little kids, but I remember having this impression that their kids seemed more adult than the parents. They fit the stereotype, artistic bohemian. They were my first artists. Here they were living a life. I fell in love with them as a family and the whole idea of what they did.
Fran was primarily responsible for my moving away from the small-scale photo paintings toward the life-size portraits and still lifes that I started doing then. We have always had a dynamic and active effect on each other's work, and we have been relentless in keeping each other's standards as high as we dared.
But of course, they suffered materially because of the way they were. So I watched them carefully, and I wasn't entirely convinced of their lifestyle. It was very chaotic, erratic. I didn't think they were particularly good parents. I mean, art was very important. You know, the kids right into their teenage years and into their 20s, and unfortunately the daughter, Lydia, passed away a year ago. She was probably in her early 40s. She was troubled in her life, addiction and mental illness problems. And Vincent, the son, became a meditator. Both Fran and Greg discovered meditation and did a lot of retreats. I remember Vincent, at age 13, went on a meditation retreat. That's just an unusual thing for a 13-year-old kid to want to do. The family sort of disintegrated at some point when Greg and Fran were doing badly. The second wife, Peggy, was a friend of Fran's first. I think that they met at a meditation retreat. Greg and Fran split up. Greg lived by himself for a while, and then he bought another house with Peggy over in Belchertown.
When I look at some of his paintings from his Italian years, there is an attitude about sexuality that is really kind of frightening.
I'll say.
It was this kind of combination of the banal with the horrifying.
What did that mean? Gosh, it seemed to me he was trying his hardest to deal with that stuff.
It comes out motivated more by a kind of horror of sex rather than a sensual approach to it. The brassiere is like a clamp. I'm pretty sure that when I've painted clothing like that, it signified the idea of repression, the notion of the flesh being constricted. This is not sensual. Her body is explicit, but everything is stiff. The clothing represses her. Her teeth are emphasized, but I think that's because I probably lack the skill to paint a smile convincingly. Her smile looks good because it's also like a snarl. It was a complexity I liked. This is the painting they punctured when it was exhibited in Italy. Probably because it showed pubic hair. Italians never paint that. Maybe they do today, but they didn't in the older tradition. The little boy I didn't paint at all. He's really a photograph. So the two painted figures seem real, and the other two seem like ghosts. But psychologically, you want them to relate to one another. Everybody has this need to make sense out of things. The mind strains to make sense.
He was very charismatic, very attractive to women, even though he was a total mess. You know, the way he dressed was mismatched socks, paint here, paint there. No concern at all for his appearance. But immediately, you just got drawn into this guy's honesty and his directness. So women were crazy about him. And yet, he didn't know what to do with that. I would have to say his sexual encounters were minimal, and he almost invariably, it seemed to me, ended up in relations with them. So you got Fran, and then you have Peggy, and I think there might have been a few others, but in some ways he didn't know that he had this power.
The man sitting was originally a photograph of Giorgio de Chirico at his easel, sitting with a paintbrush in his hand and with his shirt on. The girl was from another source completely.
And And the woman he chose, if you think of the partnering of a person and what you get and what you could get, he could have been with women better for him in the long run. I remember the last girlfriend he had, it was a year before he killed himself, and she was a very dynamic woman. These are women who are attracted to him in appearance and the fact that he was this very well-established artist, and he had these wonderful sympathetic traits that men sometimes lack, sensitivity, that kind of thing. But they kind of took over his life. And I remember him saying about this last relationship he had, he said, "No, I think I might have found something, but no, it's the same old thing."
In fairness to the women in his life, it is quite clear that Gregory had some serious gender issues.
I'm not sure now what this picture means. I was intrigued by the male-female theme. The hermaphroditic theme is connected with my idea of the artist, perhaps with all of us. It's a theme I played with a lot. I thought at that time that the artist had to unite both.
Looking at his paintings, one would tend to believe that the roles of mother and sexual partner blur in his mind. One wonders if he was the easiest of husbands.
This is no secret. Peggy became a lesbian. They adopted a child, and they had a lot of rocky times. I remember he tried to divorce her, and she says, "You can't do that. We have an adopted child. You can't do that to an adopted child."
So they didn't get divorced?
Peggy and Greg didn't, no.
People ask us if we knew Gregory. We saw him maybe five times in our life, and those quite briefly. We happened to both be in San Diego at the same time. He was there hanging his retrospective, and we were in the same hotel. And we kind of bumped into each other over breakfast, and for a couple of days, we would have these wonderful conversations. Gregory was the sort of person who was extremely open, very gregarious and interested in people. He loved to talk to people, and within seconds of sitting down with him, we would be in the middle of a really wonderful, very interesting, substantive, deep conversation about art and life and other things. The third morning, he didn't show up, and we were devastated because it was so much fun. And we learned afterwards that Gregory had avoided coming down because he thought maybe he was imposing in our lives. Why he would think such a thing, I have no idea, but some kind of insecurity that other people were more important than he was and that he was intruding. But oddly enough, we never visited him in his studio out of somewhat the same feeling, that we didn't want to intrude, which was extremely stupid. And by the time we got around to calling, he had already killed himself, so we never did. It's this person you feel very intimate with, partly because we lived with his art and did a lot of research on him and his life, and yet we hardly knew him. And he is in many ways still a deeply mysterious person.
Robin, was he generally a fairly happy guy?
Oh, yeah. Greg was a very positive person and very upbeat and very affable to everyone. Everybody was like his best friend when they were with him.
You said he organized all sorts of fun group activities.
Oh, yeah. Every summer we had a badminton party or two, and in the winter we had ping pong parties. They were kind of artist parties.
We played softball out in Williamsburg, which is so much fun, and then badminton became the game and barbecue.
You know, whenever Greg said, even if it were days before, everybody came and we all had a great time. And he was also very athletic and into sports and very social. If not for him, I think a lot of artists would not have gotten together.
Did he have recurring bouts of depression?
No, I did not see that. People talked about that after he took his life, but I guess that was why it was particularly a shock for me, because I always thought he was pretty positive. I mean, he could complain like anybody could complain. Certainly, he thought he should have been recognized more and had more retrospectives. And I just saw maybe a few days before he took his life that he seemed particularly apprehensive and upset.
Did he see a psychiatrist or take Prozac or anything that might have helped her?
He saw a therapist. Greg processed a lot, everything. Well, I think you really get a sense of it when you read his journals.
A lot of people ask me, why did Greg kill himself? They don't have to say it was a bunch of negative things in his life. unhappy in love, perhaps. Getting older, he had some kind of skin cancer. It wasn't a threatening cancer, but it was something he thought about, so he thought about mortality.
I had a strange hospital experience, and this painting came out of it. If you've ever had any experience with hospitals, you know it can be a kind of madness. They put me into a category and gave me stuff I didn't need, one of those catch-22s. I guess it was those nurses in that clinical setting and the mad leer on their faces juxtaposed against very rational elements that didn't fit.
His kids, I remember bumping into him on the street, and I said, "How are you doing, Greg?" And he'd always say, "Well, I'm feeling really shitty right now because I just kind of realized that both of my kids are middle-aged and never going to get better. The pressures of troubled kids." And then there was financial pressure because he wasn't selling paintings towards the end of his life. He was on a stipend from the Forum Gallery, and he was terrifically in debt to that gallery at that point.
Fame and position in the pecking order of the art world are not guaranteed to last forever. Gregory's 1977 Hirshhorn show was a hard act to follow. He certainly did some amazing paintings after that. I am not an art critic and cannot say why Gregory's sales went down towards the later years of his life. But Scott did tell me some stories that might suggest some reasons.
We watched him, his friends who knew and admired his paintings, and we watched him slowly alter his style. And there was a sort of hubris to him because he was supported by his gallery. He was acknowledged as a great painter, had a lot of fans. We rented a house for a month on the Cape Cod. His family and me and my girlfriend, we all lived in this house. He had just seen a major Picasso show in New York. All he did was bring a sketchbook down to the Cape with a lot of colored markers. And you see in his later paintings, they're kind of cartoony male-female stuff. And I think he believed Picasso can do it, why can't I? Why can't I just do a quick sketch and have it be as great as my paintings could take weeks of detail? And that entered into his paintings more. He got so much support for his work no matter what he did. Of course, the Buddhist people, you know, who didn't know much about art, thought it was great what he was doing, expressing himself that way. But if you're just getting down to nuts and bolts, what makes a good painting? They don't know shit, the Buddhist people.
Was Gregory a practicing Buddhist?
I don't know what the definition of that is, but he was very involved with it. He once had a teacher. You know, I didn't call him a guru. He didn't like that. This teacher commanded almost that Greg stop painting for a year as a spiritual exercise.
Did he do it?
No, he did it for a while, but then he quit. He did a lot of mind-altering drugs early on, LSD and stuff like that, and pot. And then he was clean for a long time. And then I think the last 3 or 4 years of his life, he did take up smoking pot again every day. Smoke a joint and go down to the studio and work. I think it was maybe 2 months before he killed himself. I was visiting over at his studio, and he said, "Oh, I'm so depressed. I quit smoking pot." And I come down to the studio now, and I realize everything I've done for the last 5 years is shit. Because I'm stoned all the time, and I just kind of let that happen.
I don't know about that. The frightening wilderness of depression doesn't always make for accurate self-assessment. The anonymous collectors have a different take on Gregory's late work.
I've always thought that what Gregory was doing in those last years was working toward another invention of himself, which wasn't entirely new because he had always had that side to him, but it had never been the mainstream of his painting. And I think what happened was he no longer could make himself work in the way that he had in the middle period of the 70s and 80s, where he did these amazingly rendered portraits, you know, infinitely painstaking, and he just couldn't make himself do it anymore. He couldn't. What he wanted was something more spontaneous and more freewheeling. And he was working towards something. The tragedy is he didn't live long enough to fully realize it.
Greg and I had our differences over the years. He was very critical. I remember at some point I just stopped inviting him to come to my studio because I can imagine that he wouldn't have liked my paintings. There's many years of that. And although we were still friendly, there was this kind of standoff. And I remember feeling, as I got older, well, I'm not a kid anymore, I'm not a student anymore, I'm an equal, Greg, because he always did very well, and I did well enough myself, so I didn't ever come close to what his stature was. And sometimes I thought he could have been more generous. We used to talk about that, how Greg would say little things. But what happened, and this is just a month before he died, he gave me a call, and he said, Scott, I'm downtown. You want to come down and have some coffee with me? And I went down, and I thought, oh, what's he going to pull this time? We're sitting there, and the first thing he says is, Scott, I just want to tell you that I saw your show. It's a mid-career retrospective. He said, I just want to tell you that I thought you do great paintings. He never said that before. He never said that before. He says, you do great paintings. And he says, I have to confess that I've at times been jealous of you. And I'm there, Craig, I've been jealous of you. And it was just like this beautiful moment of revelation and apology and let's start over again. And sorry, and he killed himself, for God's sakes. So anyway, that was a big deal. And I think I've heard from other people that he did that with them too. And, you know, some of us are wondering, was he doing something there? Was he preparing to go? There's all these things coming together. The last week before he killed himself, apparently, he was really depressed and wasn't sleeping. When that happens, it's like throwing gasoline on a fire. You know, you start to get sleep deprived and you have this depression building, you know, paralyzing you. But I believe that if he had just gone to a doctor and gotten some pills so at least he could sleep, I don't think he would have killed himself. I've often said, if I had the choice of picking five paintings from any artist, one of them would have been Greg. What I miss about him is that take on things, just deep thinking and very intelligent, you know, questioning, always questioning himself, his motives, and all that. And it's gold when you have people in your lives who challenge you, bring up subjects that are not superficial. Nothing superficial about that guy at all.
Intellectually, I'm one thing. Emotionally, I'm something else. It creates a kind of schizophrenia, which art is able to express. My art is based on contradiction. There's nothing simple in it. It's always multiple.
Robin Friedenfeld told me that no one she has ever known was as obsessed with painting as her friend, Gregory Gillespie.
That was his life. I mean, he had friends and he had a family, but his life was his work.
Did Gregory Gillespie have something that bothered him his whole life? I think he did. He could push it down underneath for periods of time, but never make it fully disappear.
My background was Catholic, and I grew up in a very restricted and repressed social environment. The feeling of being trapped, and there's a lot of anguish and pain in that. Like a delicate organism being born in the world, and the kind of violence that's done to it as a matter of course. If I'm painting the inside of a wound, it feels different than if I were painting on the surface of some other thing. It's a very intuitive, emotional process. I like it much better when it's really under the surface, like when I paint rutabagas or self-portraits, and it's really packed underneath with tension. Underneath.